नमस्ते एवरीवन, गुड इवनिंग. दिस इज डॉक्टर अपर्णा. दिस इज द एपिसोड 1 ऑफ माइंड योर मेंटल वेलनेस पॉडकास्ट. आई एम एन आयुर्वेदिक साइकोथेरेपिस्ट, अ पैशनेट आयुर्वेदा एंड साइकोथेरेपी इन्फोप्रीनर एंड अ मेडिकल राइटर इन माय परस्यूट to address, promote, and propagate Ayurveda and psychotherapy globally. I come up with discussions on Ayurveda, mental health, psychotherapy, and related aspects. I do book reviews on these genres as well. So, today, this morning, you know, when I was thinking of why, you know, mental health education and awareness are crucial for the present day. See, mental health is an essential part of our overall well-being. See, just as important as physical health. Because mental health affects our ability to think, to feel, and to act. Strong mental health allows us to handle stress, relate to others, and make choices that contribute to our overall well-being. So, see, mental health education and awareness are crucial because of, you know, present day there are increasing mental health issues. The fast pace of life, the social media pressures, and the economic uncertainties contribute to a rise in mental health issues like anxiety, depression, and addiction. So education equips people to recognize signs and symptoms in themselves and others. So, and there is reduced stigma. So, you know, stigma. Mental health problems are often, you know, shrouded in stigma, preventing people from seeking help. People always hesitate to seek mental health help. So awareness campaigns and education, you know, can normalize mental health issues. So encouraging people to talk openly and seek support. So, and also improved coping mechanisms. See, mental health education teaches individuals healthy coping skills such as stress management, relaxation techniques, and communication skills. So these tools empower them to navigate challenges and maintain emotional well-being. See, and early intervention. See, early identification and intervention are crucial for managing mental health concerns effectively. So education here plays an important role and helps people recognize, you know, symptoms and encourages them to seek help before problems escalate. And it also has positive impact on all aspects of life. Good mental health can significantly improve one's quality of life. It impacts academic performance, work productivity, relationships, and overall sense of well-being. So Ayurveda, if you ask me, what does Ayurvedic approach to a mental well-being means? So Ayurveda offers a unique and valuable contribution to mental health. It delves beyond the physical symptoms to address the root cause of mental imbalances, promoting lasting well-being. So, mind-body connection. So, Ayurveda emphasizes the interconnectedness of mind and body. So, psychosomatic interconnectedness. So, mental health issues are often seen as manifestations of underlying imbalances in the doshas. So, vata, pitta, and kapha. Or gunas, sattva, rajas and tamas. See, Ayurveda believes that physical health is crucial for mental health and mental health is crucial for physical health. So the cause of disease lies not only in the body but also in the mind and soul, says Charakacharya. So treatment should address all of them. And there is a therapy, the chikitsa, which is named Sattvavajaya Chikitsa, which can be correlated to Ayurvedic psychotherapy that emphasizes the power of mind to heal itself. So we use various meditation techniques, yoga, therapies, dietary modifications to cultivate mental clarity and emotional balance. So for this today, I have a special guest with me, you know, to talk about mental health and psychotherapy. So our guest today is the founder of Reach Out, and she is a passionate psychotherapist. Earlier, she was a homeopathy doctor, and she is a TEDx speaker and an international corporate trainer. So she's working in the space of relationship and wellness, having trained more than 5,000 teachers and more than 2,000 workshops. She believes in creating safe and compassionate, you know, human being. So that is her motive. So let's welcome Dr. Neeta Mhatre. Hello, doctor.
Hello, and very, very good evening.
Good evening. Namaste. And thank you for sparing time for this discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you and namaste. And good evening, everyone. Thank you so much, Dr. Aparna, for giving me a chance and an opportunity to talk on awareness of mental health and why it is important to now openly talk about anything which is challenging. Because it is not only challenging for that person, it is also challenging and overwhelming for the family members and the caregivers.
Yes, thank you very much. So let's delve into the discussion without wasting any time. I would want to ask you your journey from being a homeopathic doctor to founding, you know, Reach Out. Tell us about, you know, your inclination towards psychotherapy, mental health, and how did you, come to found, you know, you wanted to, you know, found, there is a necessity for, you know, Reach Out. So please let us know.
Thank you for this question, because this has been a very amazing journey, and the journey started only with me. The journey started with me when I was going through some of my personal issues, and I had to meet a counselor. I had to meet a marital counselor, and she was very open in telling that if I sit and listen to your story, probably I will not be able to finish up all my cases, all my 350 files. So why can't you just make decisions as early as possible rather than always having dates to meet a counselor? And then I felt that being a counselor, it becomes your duty, because that is why you are qualified to be a counselor, that you need to listen to a person. And somehow I was not convinced with her while she was giving all the reasons for not listening, and I had all the reasons for telling. Though I eventually changed her, I eventually looked out for someone much better. And that is where the journey started for going ahead, studying psychology, taking admission in MSW, then seeking that, you know, this is not going to just stop, because it's not just a talk. A person has to be working on the trauma. There are a lot of underlying causes. There are a lot of underlying reasons. So how about going ahead and studying and mastering some few more techniques?
True.
So one by one, I started filling my bucket, and I think that's how the journey started. And while this journey started, I really could see out that there was not only one Neeta who had a problem, but there were many Neeta who were not actually heard of, who were not actually allowed to even go out and speak. So working in the community, creating a safe space in the community, creating a non-judgmental space in the community. And that is where the Reach Out has started. And Reach Out has been catering to destitute girls. Reach Out has been catering for a special program for the LGBTQI community. And Reach Out looks after single parents. Here, the single parents are not gender biased. It can be male, it can be female, it can be whosoever who are single parents and who are on the verge of living a dignity and a beautiful life.
What is actually the role of Reach Out? How do people reach out to Reach Out?
So that's beautiful, very, very nicely said. How do people reach out to Reach Out? While working in the community, we do not advertise, we do not talk about it, or I do not put it anything on the social media, but people who have been working with me, there are a few of my interns who worked with me. They are still working with me. So it's always been word of mouth. and while doing small community, connecting to some NGOs, doing some programs with the NGOs, and then they are seeing the difference which is getting created. So that is how only through word of mouth, reach out has been able to reach out to people.
Yeah, but if a lay person has to reach out for what all concerns, they can reach out.
They can connect on my website.
Oh, okay. Any mental health concern?
Any mental health concern and any social health concern also. Because what happens, I feel every health is related to each other. Rather, it is interlinked. So though I talk that physically I am not well, if I am not well physically, I am not well even mentally. And if I am not well mentally, I do not want to meet people socially. I do not want that nariyal pani, please. I don't want that. So I'm also affecting my social health. And while my social health is getting impacted, finally my financial health is also getting impacted.
True.
So all the health is actually interrelated. And while people always put the health on the last agenda, the health
especially
is last.
Especially the mental health.
Yes, especially the mental health. Whether it is mental health, nowadays I'm seeing people trying all the Google formulas sitting in the house, even for the physical health. And then it becomes very, very extreme. And then they come to the doctors or to the physicians or to the specialist. But I see a very, very late entry whenever it is about health. Work is always important. Money is always important. Bringing a very good lavish house is very important, but health is always considered last, sleep is considered last, rest is considered last. In fact, they do not understand all these things are so much related to have good physical health as well as good mental health.
True. But what are the trends you are seeing in your psychotherapy practice? What is the major mental health concerns you are addressing in your practice, if you have to, you know, say?
So of lately, at least I can say for this year of 24, I'm seeing a lot of issues which is related to confidence and fear. And it's not about the confidence in expression. It's about, it's about the confidence which people want to see. And here people are scared to show that I know I'm confident, but why is it important for me that someone else has to see my confidence? And the second thing, when I'm talking about fear, your fear is about projections. Somewhere down
the line, people constantly seek validation.
They seek validation because that's how we raise up our children. That's how they see the parents. You know, in case if they see the mother dressing up, or in case if they see the father for a change wearing something different, we are doing that validation in the house itself. Main thing is we are not preparing the generation to listen the word no. Which is a complete sentence by itself.
True.
So whether it is a girlfriend, whether it is a boyfriend, whether it is getting admission, whether it is trying for a new skill, they're all scared and they're very fearful. So this is what has been my journey for this year, that I'm seeing a lot of confidence issue. I'm seeing the issues related to fear. However, while working in the space of LGBTQI community, I'm seeing a very good openness, because that is again which is my area where I in the community I'm seeing a good change which has come, a very positive change which has come, that the parents are now open to understanding the terminologies. What is gay? What is lesbian? Okay, how does this work? What are some of the plus and minuses which we as parents have to remember? How can I become neutral? How can I be gender neutral even in addressing? So I'm seeing a very good awareness which has come in the society and which has really been helpful.
in continuation with the question, what is your practice or reach out doing to, you know, help trans community? What is the work that is going on with the community, and what do you think is needed from people, from us, to contribute? Or you can show some light on it. Yeah.
So reach out works in two spaces. One, it is social emotional learning with the trans, and second is working on their own emotional trauma. And while working on their emotional trauma, it is like becoming ready, even going out to define themselves, who they are, how they are, and making them mentally prepared to go out and work with dignity. So this is what I've been doing, or the entire team of Reach Out does in the space with the community. The second thing, coming to awareness or coming to bringing in some help from the public outside or from people who are interested in participating, let's have a communication which is dignified and which is respectful. Because it's not about them, but it's about us. If I am dignified and I'm respectfully talking and addressing my concerns, my emotions, I will definitely understand somebody else's concerns and their problems also. So having respect, the second thing which I also believe is maintaining integrity. If you listen to somebody's problem or issue, if you can help, please be there. But if you can't help, don't make fun of it and spread it across to the people. Because integrity matters. So definitely that integrity matters. The third thing, which is not the last and not the least, but it is the most important thing, is please empathize with people. When you empathize with people, they feel really good. Nobody is interested in only being sympathized. Just empathize and leave the person.
True.
Just empathize with them.
What do you see the trends? Like, are people more accepting of LGBTQ community, or how do you see in your practice?
So let me tell you that I'm also a behavioral trainer, and as a behavioral trainer, I've been going to a lot of corporates, having trainings, even talking on DEI. So I think this whole space is now really becoming much more aware. It is also getting accepted, and people are now becoming very conscious about how to also behave. So there is acceptance which is there. There is a very easy way of approaching. So anyone from the community can be approached very easily. Initially, we were very scared, you know, all that belief which was made in our mind when we were seeing them on traffic signals begging, or we were seeing them doing any kind of prostitution. We were very scared of all those things. But now those myths are really getting worked on. People are working on those myths and making a safe space for them, as well as a safe space for them to come back to the offices also.
Do you see, like, in our practice, we usually see patients with stress, anxiety, and depression. These are the major things that we see. What are the trends that you see in your practice?
So let me tell you that I would not like to tag them as patients, because what happens is, while you tag anyone with stress, for some people, stress is very, very positive. For some people, the stress is too overwhelming.
Yes, yes. You stress and be stress. Yeah.
Yes. So if I talk to a salesperson, for sales, they love stress because they know that it is always the last minute work which they're able to complete the whole thing. So I don't actually tell them as patients unless they are not clinically identified as them. So I understand that stress, of course, it's not a part and parcel of life, because you need to understand where your boundaries are and how are you also taking care of your boundaries. So if you're taking care of your boundaries, there is no stress at all. But in case if you're not taking care of your healthy boundaries, 100% you will be in stress. Talking about anxiety, anxiety is always been there. Our social media, our televisions have always created anxiety. Meri saadi, tumhari saadi se safed kaisi? So it started all from outside. And while it was happening from outside, we never understood that how did it also become part of us internally. And internally, without even understanding, the mind is giving me a different story. The narratives are different. The feeling is different. And then my anxiety comes over. While talking about depression, somehow social media has also been contributing in the cases of depression. Depression, I think, at least for me, for this year, I have not had any new cases, but a follow-up which is going on. Definitely depression, as per the census, it is increased. But I also understand that somewhere we as humans are responsible for this depression. However, our houses are very big, but there is hardly one or two people who are staying in the house. And those one or two people who are staying in the house have so much of work themselves that they do not have time to talk to each other. While they come back home, the time is haywire. Then it is so tiredness. Then again, preparation for the next day that we are missing on with the conversations which used to be happening. Where people used to come out, talk to each other, visit family members. Now it is like you need to give a month's intimation. Hey, I'm going to come to your house. I think slowly, eventually, it will become RSVP even to the family members.
Right. You are a corporate behavior trainer. So,
So I'm saying the family was initially a very bigger family. From bigger family. Yeah. Family.
Yeah.
So all the three families are which we are seeing. Nuclear, big family, nuclear family and individualistic family. So I think here it is where we are seeing that depression is seeping in. A lot of judgments are coming in. Every time we feel that, you know, my skill is lesser than somebody else's skill. People are always in constant FOMO, right? So,
and usually normal sadness is also misconstrued as depression. Clinical depression is different and normal sadness is different because we tend to get sad. You know, we are human beings, so we tend to get sad. So that is not, you know, depression.
I totally agree this.
Because it is always misconstrued that I am always sad, so that's why that is depression. No, clinical depression is very much different from normal sadness.
Absolutely, absolutely. In case if people take out some time to be alone or to be with themselves, immediately comes, okay, what's wrong with you? It could be just someone wants to just put everything off and be with himself or herself. But it's immediately asked, what happened? Is something wrong? Did something go wrong? So my mind has got so tuned in asking anything which is wrong. It can be positive also. Why can't I give that chance to think, yes, it is positive, you know? So I think some of these definitions and some of these myths, it's time to now work on these.
True. And you are a corporate behavior trainer. You have trained so many people. So what sort of training is given in corporate training for our viewers and how does it impact their performance, productivity or mental health? What do you work on?
So I've been working on very, very important is mental health awareness. How do you even identify the red flags? And it is need to identify the red flags before tagging people, before talking about them, or before even understanding that someone else has a problem. So if the performance is getting affected, A, first of all, talk to the person. Maybe there would be some areas where the person is lacking some kind of skill. Second, is the person passionate or is the person really ready to do the job? Though everything is written in the CV, but is that CV thing actually coinciding with the work, what the person is doing there, right? Work culture, work environment, how is the work culture, how is the work environment? Is there people who are really genuinely practicing empathy? So bringing in these things, I bring in a lot of emotional intelligence, I bring in stress management, I bring in conflict, I also bring in a very, very nice, which I love, is social-emotional balance, understanding the needs of why it is important to identify your own emotions and feelings, and how does it also impact your own behavior as well as your surroundings. And of lately, at least past 15 days, I'm continuously been talking to the corporates on rest and sleep.
Sleep.
So what is rest and what is sleep and why the sleep is important to have a good physical body, to have a good mental health body, and not to get into any social anxiety and take care of your finances.
So there is a myth, like I feel that is a myth, that people feel that the more hours you put in, that means the more you're busy, the more you're productive. And what do you think its impact on, mental health? And when you speak of corporates, there is always corporate politics, which people are bothered very much, which the employees are bothered whenever working in, corporate politics. So what do you have to say about the corporate politics, how to deal with it, without being mentally screwed?
So I know one very important definition of corporate is A, you are not there to make friends or family. Very clear and very practical. You are just there to work. And while you work, just keep all your senses open. That is your eyes, your ears, and your mouth only open when it is needed. Somehow, who I am in my personal way, I bring my personality the same in my professional space also. So if I'm always on the mode of advisory, picking up on people, talking about them, interfering in people's work, I will always be the same person in my professional space also. So you need to wear your hats very mindfully. I am in my personal space. I do not like people interfering. Very good. The same is for my professional space. In my professional space, let's come, let's work. And while you work timely, if you work timely on your desk job, or in case if it is even site work, if you can really work with your timings, there is nothing where you really have to wait back, do a lot of other works. No. You can go back on time. But if I'm doing rest of the other work, but not doing my own work, definitely the politics are there. People don't leave you. People in the houses, even with the relatives, when they don't leave us, in fact, being a family, so here is not my family. Here they are people. And we need to understand that the people have to be put in the space of people. Work together, work in harmony. It's okay to have a good smile. It's okay to greet people. It's okay to have respect, but do not forget your boundaries. Do not nudge into people's personal, whatever it could be. So while you maintain a healthy boundary, I think the corporate politics is something where you can just keep yourself away from.
True, but there is also one thing. People usually, come to us saying that I mind my own business. I don't interfere in other people's business. But other people do. There is cutthroat competition. People take away, your work credit or job credits all these things happen. So I think this is also a concern to stress and anxiety.
Yes, that is a very, very deepest concern for stress and anxiety. And I think this was also happening earlier, but earlier people never opened their mouth and said about it. But now what I'm also seeing is, if someone is taking due credit of your work and you are so with what you are doing, you need to stand for yourself. And until unless you don't stand for yourself, you will not get any support, you will not get any kind of assistance, but definitely you need to stand for yourself. And while standing for yourself, please remember, like a lot of people, you know, my mobile is being traced, my mobile talks are getting recorded, this is happening, that is happening. 100% I agree, a lot of corporate plays a very dirty politics. They do that. I completely agree. But that doesn't mean that you need to succumb to all those policies. Who you are and how you are, always be on that track and be very clear with your boundaries, be very clear with what you want to speak and how do you want to speak and when do you want to speak. Always continuously speaking might not help. And people who are taking up your work, please congratulate them. And tell them that I'm so proud that you have done this work so meticulously. And I feel so great that I was of some help for you to reach at this place. Please congratulate them. Because I myself know, I write some quotes and I love doing that. It can be only two-liner, it can be one-liner. And I remember one day in one of my Facebook Messenger, there was this lady who wrote to me that, you know, past 3 to 4 years I've been seeing your quotes and I don't want to tell you anything, but I have made a small handbook of all those quotes. And after 3 years, why am I telling you this is because somewhere I felt that probably I'm doing a wrong thing. And I was like, wow, that's so nice. I don't know you. But somewhere inside you felt that you are doing a wrong thing because you got it published, you got it made. She made a small handbook of quotes. And then she told me, do you still think that I should give you a credit? I said, no. You already gave me the credit by telling me. Right? So sometimes it's the whole circle. Life is a whole circle. It comes back, it gives you back. So congratulate people to who they are and tell them, I'm so glad that I contributed in your growth.
True. And, you know, one more thing is, before, you know, questions, what do you think that, you know, we as a society and people can do to, and we as psychotherapists and doctors and psychologists working in these spectrum do to, you know, increase mental health awareness? And what can a society as a whole do? There are so many aspects to it. So people, what happens is initially people are not ready to accept because of the taboo that they have a mental health issue. Because people think that people will laugh at them. They will not sympathize or empathize with them. They will laugh at them. They will make fun of them. But it is reducing. The stigma is coming down. The what we can do as you know, doctors, and what can society do and what can people do to approach, you know, who have issues they can approach. So what can be done as a whole? Like, you know.
So I think very well you asked that, what can we do as a whole? I always understand that if I'm giving someone the problem, some or the other way around, the problem will come back to me. A, it is very important while we talk on these subjects, whether it is subject of mental health, whether it is a physical complaint of, say, diabetes or hypertension. Whenever it is diabetes, hypertension, fracture, fever, we take it seriously, right? We take it seriously. We consult the right kind of people. In the same way, I think now it is important to normalize the topic of mental health. And while normalizing the topic of mental health, people are only scared of one thing, that if somebody is laughing on me or if somebody is making fun of me, do I have my family's back? Please be a good supporter, a supporter which is very clear that I don't expect anything, but I'm going to support you. Be that 3 a.m. friend when someone wants to really talk to you, when someone wants to express that to you. The generation today is a real loner generation. While the parents are busy in making money, are busy in making a good livelihood, but still, while they come back home, there is complete silence. Planning out a vacation is not the answer. Have small dinners together. Have that 1 hour of completely mobile out. Just be with each other. Talk to each other.
Communication.
How was your day? Connect with people rather than connecting with people on social media whom you do not know also, and who might not be your 3M friend, but connect with people. Co-create memories in the houses, co-create memories with people whom you are even comfortable. And third is, please remember that you are the pilot of your aeroplane, nobody else. So do not allow anyone else to take decisions for you. Do not give the remote of your happiness into somebody else's hands, because you matter. And until unless you are not okay, however the world is okay, it is still not okay. So you need to take charge.
And one more thing is, self-love is talked of lately too much. Self-love as it is important, but when do you think the self-love turn into, selfishness? The people are like, one category is like self-love, one category is like it is being selfish or being self-centered. So what is the extent to which you think, so what is self-love and what is being selfish or self-centered?
So actually, self-love and selfish or being self-centered are three different concepts. I am talking to you. I am talking to you because A, I've been invited on this show, but I self-love myself because it's not about only I, and I. The I, and I is selfish. I do not put up where people talk to me that you don't talk about your work, you don't write anything, why don't you do this, why don't you do that, you don't market yourself. The I is not about marketing. I is about feeling contented about what I do, and that is self-love for me. But while this self-love, if it becomes obsessed and it goes to the stage of being selfish and self-centered, there is only the time then I will. Dr. Neeta Mhatre would like to think that I would do only things which will make me feel happy, which will make me feel seen, which will make me feel wanted, which may make feel everything only and around me. So there are people who are understanding ki no, I don't want to help anyone, because if I come to know, I should not tell this to someone. So there is where selfishness starts off. Those people are not ready to share. Those people are not ready to even care for others. Whereas people with self-love, as they know, their boundaries are very clearly defined, but they will be their well-wishers. They will help people. People who are selfish, they might not at all even come out to even see what's happening in your space. People who become self-centered, there is always some kind of story behind becoming a self-centered. Generally, we as humans are social animals. We do not be self-centered, but people who come to that extreme of being a self-centered, there is a story behind it. And while the story is there behind it, please understand that it is good to respect. It is good to be, again, taking care of their boundaries. However, if they are happy or if they have to spread out wishfully, then please go ahead and ask for help. But usually self-centered people, at times they come out of their comfort zone and genuinely help. But people who are selfish are very clear, you know, this is my area, I can do only so much, beyond that I do not want to.
See, what I feel is, you know, you can take time out for yourself. That is not, that could be self-love. You can have your boundaries. You know, you can do whatever you want, but it should not be at the cost of harming others.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Completely. And empathy and grace is also equally important with, you know, self-love. That's what, you know, I believe. And the major health concerns, doctor, I see in teens, mental health concerns, majorly is seen in teens. How do you think parents can, you know, teenagers, what is the role of teenagers and what is the role of parents in controlling teen mental health issues or adolescent mental health issues?
So, doctor, I'm a bit very careful about words and I use words very meticulously. So, instead of control, I would like to use the word manage. And here it is not about the teens, but here it is about matured parents.
No. Concerns are seen in teen. We see concerns around, you know, 12 to 18 years of age or 19 years of age. Yeah, those.
Yeah, I'm talking about that. So concerns are seen over there, but the concerns of the parents, which has to be professional, has to be coming to a professional for an help. Instead of going to the professional, they will find out all the other ways and means. They will go to Pandit, they will go to all Rahu, Ketu, Shani, Puja, but they will not approach the right person. Okay? Second, the parents should stop comparing themselves and their problems with or bringing in examples. Ki when I was at your age, even I had the same problem, but I tackled it like this. So here it is not again about the comparison or bringing in examples. Probably the child now is feeling what he or she is feeling. You need to address their concerns. And while addressing the concerns, if as parents, if I feel that I can manage it to some extent, please help. But beyond that, if you know that you can't manage, do not deny taking help of the professionals. The professional help is needed. And once it is needed, once it is properly guided, and it has been brought to a specific or to a condition which is now manageable, then the parents again should get involved. But I think as parent, if my child has a problem and my child comes and tells me the problem, I need to listen. I should not tell that, no, there is no problem. There are students, while I go to the schools, they tell that my parents, they do not have time to even listen to me, that I don't like maths. And why don't you like maths? Because it is so difficult. Nobody is there to teach me. But you still go to tuitions, right? And what happens when you go to tuitions? In the tuition, they are doing four problems on the board and they are telling, copy, go home. But I can't understand here anything. And if I will tell this to my parents, they tell, we are paying so much big money for your education. And you still can't understand. So I think that is the irony, that what has to be understood has to be given time, has to be given nurturing, and has to be handled with care.
I do agree. Listening and communication is the, you know, giving time to their children is an important part. And also comparison is always the thief of joy. Comparing your children to other children, that also, not only comparing their past, but also comparing your children to other children is too much nowadays. He has got first rank, she has got first rank, you did not get that. Or that comparison is always the thief of joy.
main thing I also see one more thing that parents are not even aware which kind of board or which kind of curriculum they just take admissions because my friend's son is there, my sister-in-law's daughter is there. So why do we have to compete with your daughter-in-law or with your friend? You do not know the board, you do not know the curriculum, you do not know what is that board going to give in future. It is just becoming a fashion that CBSE, international, IGSE. Why do we need to compare things also? Do you know what are the repercussions which the child faces? The child is continuously being tagged. The child has his own pressure. The child has the peer pressure. There is so much which goes on with the child himself. So I think it is very important that the parenting has to be a conscious parenting. If you are ready for all the responsibility, please be parent. If you are not responsible or if you feel that I cannot really manage, it's okay. Don't be a parent. I know I'm sounding very blunt, but that is the reality. That is the reality.
True. Do you offer any courses? Does the Reach Out offer any courses?
So I think I'm going to very soon start off with very small courses and small easy courses, which everyone, it's not necessary that you need to be from science or you need to be from arts or you need to be from the psychology, but I am on the verge of making courses, which is going to be easy and understood and as well as practiced. So very soon you will see that.
Okay. Last words, last question. What do you have to say about, mind your mental wellness, and what do you have to say to our viewers watching today? Your last message.
So my last message for all the viewers who are watching today or who might watch later, please don't run away from your own self. Take regularly pause, sit with yourself, analyze yourself, do your self audit. People who are not good for your mental health, whether it is your relatives, whether it is your friends, whether it is your colleagues, whether it is your acquaintances, anyone, whosoever is not good for your mental health, please keep them at a safer distance. And remember, as the movie was there, Zindagi na milegi dobara, you might not get the same life back. So make the best of it. Make the happiest moment every time, wherever you are. Create memories for self, because that's always going to be with you. And you are okay, then only the world is okay, and you are not okay, it doesn't make sense. So you need to be okay.
Thank you very much, Doctor. And thank you for sparing time for the discussion. And we are very thankful for your insights. And we best wishes to you from our side. To reach out, may you reach out to millions and millions of people. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. So be it, and amen. And thank you very much. And all the people, whosoever would be watching later on, a thank you and a deep gratitude from the deep core of my heart. Thank you, and wishing you all a happy weekend. Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you. And for our viewers, you heard her. And at the end, I would only want to say this, that if you cannot help you help yourself, nobody can help you help yourself. You know, as she said, you are the pilot of your plane. So I would end this discussion by saying, mind your mental wellness. Thank you very much. This is Dr. Aparna signing off. Namaste. Stay tuned for more such discussions and information. So thank you.